if the intensity is proportional to the square of the amplitude, which we said is true, and we have the intensity is proportional to 1 over the square of the distance, right? Because as you go through larger and larger areas, the intensity must be decreasing by that area. Then you can conclude that A is proportional to 1 over R. Now, if you're not comfortable with dealing with proportionality equations, we can write it down a little bit more directly like this. We could say that explicitly, the intensity is equal to some constant, let's say A, times the amplitude squared. And A is just some constant number. And we also have that the intensity is equal to some other constant, B, I guess, divided by R squared, right? It's the same intensity, whatever it is, but it's proportional to the amplitude squared, and it's proportional to 1 over R squared. Proportional to means it's just a constant multiplied by. That's all that proportional to means. And so you can pretty quickly see here that we have A over B times A squared is equal to 1 over R squared. Just take the square root of both sides, and you get A is proportional to 1 over R. Proportional to, we just drop this constant A over B to get the proportionality. Does this make a little bit more sense than that terse thing at the bottom of the slide? Well, if that makes sense to you, let's see if you can extend your mind by one fewer dimension. This is a hard one. Suppose now instead we have, so this is sort of for 3D. Now let's go to 2D. Two dimensions would be you drop a stone in a pond, okay? And it makes a splash and ripples go out. And so you see, let me try to draw nice circles here, emanating out. These are the waves that you see traveling away from where you drop the stone in the water. Now clearly, the amplitude of these waves is going to decrease as you get farther and farther away from where the splash occurred, right? But how fast is it? Let's do it mathematically. Now we still know that the intensity is proportional to the amplitude squared. But the intensity of these waves now is spread out over larger and larger rings. And the right way to think about it is that the energy is concentrated at this wave crest here. Let's suppose at the point when we reach a certain radius, and the radius is R, right? Here's R. Certain radius away from where we drop the stone in, all that initial energy is spread out over this circle. So we need to know how much energy per unit distance along the circle we have. Our intensity is now not just energy per unit area, but energy per unit distance along the circle. And the whole circle has a circumference of 2 pi times the radius. So the same amount of energy when you go to a larger radius is spread out over a, is spread out over a larger distance, proportional to the radius. The bigger the radius, the more distance over which is spread out. So now we see that the intensity is also proportional then to 1 over what? 1 over R. And therefore, the intensity is proportional, the amplitude is proportional. I can actually erase that. Yay. The amplitude is proportional to 1 over square root of R in this case, in the two-dimensional case. Now, this can be a puzzlement for students. I urge you to go away and think about the reasoning by which we came to this. I'll try to post this online, poor as the drawing is. I'll just leave it like that for the moment. Now, talking about some specific kinds of waves, electromagnetic waves definitely carry energy, as we know, and they're pretty extraordinary. The wavelengths of electromagnetic waves can range from the radio end of the spectrum, where they're kilometers or longer in length, down to the tiniest subatomic distances you can imagine for ultra-high energy gamma rays. All right. Somewhere in the middle there is the visible part of the spectrum, which happens to be from about 400 nanometers to 700 nanometers. Now, why is it, do you suppose, that such a tiny fraction of the huge electromagnetic spectrum, which covers orders and orders of magnitude, why is just that little sliver from 400 to 700 nanometers, 10 to the minus 9th meters, visible to us? There's a perfectly logical, biological explanation for this. Yes?
Is it because that's the highest output from the sun?
Exactly.
Our sun is yellow. That's where most of the radiation we have around us is. And it so happens that it's fairly easy, or at least it became possible during evolution to arrive at biological systems which are sensitive to radiation in that range. There are animals like bees are sensitive to ultraviolet radiation. I don't know if any animals are sensitive to radio waves. Probably not, but who knows? There are odd things all the time. But yeah, the fact that the sun is yellow is why we see stuff in the yellow spectrum. That's reasonable. But you know, we tend to think about, well, if it's not visible, you can't see it. If you can't see it, it's not there. But that's certainly not true. Infrared radiation is there all the time. You feel the warmth of the sun when you walk out, even if you can't see it. Or you feel the warmth of a very warm object when you come near it. It's sending infrared radiation toward you, which is absorbed by your body, and you feel that warmth. You can't do as well with the ultraviolet end of the spectrum. If somebody shines UV light on you, you probably can't tell that somebody's shining UV light on you. That makes ultraviolet lasers particularly dangerous, and they're highly regulated and controlled in laboratory environments, and something you should be very aware of. You walk into a lab that says UV laser, make sure you're wearing glasses, okay? Because you can lose your eyes. You can lose your eyesight easily from the damage caused by ultraviolet light. Ultraviolet light has enough energy to ionize the molecules in your body, including light receptors in your eyes and your skin. Of course, you could get burned easily by ultraviolet light. Well, if you go even further to x-rays, same thing. X-rays are there whether you can see them or not. I was absolutely appalled when the federal government, via the TSA, decided it would be perfectly okay to have you walk through a machine and shoot x-rays on you and then to detect weapons on your body. This is putting you in ionizing radiation for absolutely no reason, because we can do it without ionizing radiation. All those x-ray machines are now gone. Enough people complained that this is just crazy to nuke people as they're going through the airport. What are they thinking? Oh, it's less radiation than you get from a banana. Okay, well, it's not restricted to the top hundredth of a millimeter of your skin, which is, their actual DNA there that could get cause skin cancer. Sometimes people do things that make no sense at all. Gamma rays are also highly penetrating. They can go through, this much lead, still get out. I deal with ultra-high energy gamma rays in the work I do quite a lot. We're going to come back to this when we talk about photons and electromagnetic radiation later.